Welcome to NewsClick. I'm Paranjoy Guha Thakurta, and today we're going to discuss Justice Arun Kumar Mishra, who recently retired from the Supreme Court. He retired on the 2nd of September, and arguably he was one of the most influential judges of the Apex Court of India and also one of the most controversial judges. To discuss this subject, I'm very happy to welcome senior journalist V. Venkatesan. Venkatesan is consulting editor for the Wire website. He's recently written a 5-part series of articles on Justice Mishra. He was earlier with Frontline magazine. He has 3 decades of experience as a journalist who's not only reported on politics, but particularly has specialized on legal issues, and he holds a degree in law. Thank you very much, Venkatesan, for giving us your time. My first question is that, you know, and this is very topical. After you wrote your article, your series of articles, and your very first article where you sort of introduced the judge and his family, you pointed out that, like him, his younger brother had become a judge at a very young age, before he turned 45, in fact. And he was approved by the Supreme Court Collegium. At that time, of course, the Collegium comprised Justices Ranjan Gogoi, S.A. Bobde, N.V. Ramana, and Justice Arun Mishra was 4th in the hierarchy. And you said he's not known if he recused himself from the consultation process of the collegium. Well, Venkatesan, in your article you mentioned that in the Facebook profile of Justice Arun Mishra's younger brother Vishal Mishra, he had suggested that members of the Gandhi Nehru family were Muslims. They were presented as Muslims. I mean, it was also alleged that the Gandhi family hates Hindus. And soon after your article appeared, this Facebook post was taken down. But there were, of course, pictures were taken, there were screenshots.
Screenshots.
Yes. So if you can just tell us a little bit about this particular aspect of Justice Arun Mishra's brother before we discuss him.
That's right. Yeah, for the appointment of high court judges, a smaller collegium meets. Smaller collegium of 3 senior most judges. Since Justice Arun Mishra was 4th in the hierarchy, he was not supposed to sit in any case. But you know, the way collegium operates, the allegations of give and take has always been there. So we don't know whether the 3 senior most judges of the collegium wanted to help Justice Arun Mishra, or was it entirely based on merit? Because the collegium resolution, which was uploaded, it says that there was initially some objection about the age issue. And the High Court Collegium had reconsidered the whole thing, and then they reiterated their recommendation. Therefore, we do not know what exactly was behind that final decision.
But Venkatesan, that the Facebook page was certainly Justice Vishal Mishra's is evident, because after you wrote the article, everything was taken down.
But we do not know whether it was already taken down or after. Because, you know, what I understood was that, you know, it was that the screenshot was already taken. So I don't know whether it was taken down as a result of my article or before that, we do not know, because it was a 2014 post.
Okay. Before I ask you to comment on specific judgments delivered by the retired Justice Arun Kumar Mishra, because after all, he, during his tenure in the Supreme Court, which started in July 2014, he had authored 132 judgments, and he was part of 540 benches. So before we pick on some specific judgments, if you can give an overview, why do you think he became the most influential judge in the Supreme Court, handling the most politically sensitive cases.
Yeah, so basically he was not a very prolific judge. You know, there are some prolific judges in the Supreme Court where in the course of 6 year long tenure, they have written quite a lot of judgments, not just, you know, 200 or something. So therefore, we have to place Justice Arun Mishra somewhere on a moderate scale or in terms of the frequency of judgments authored by him. Apart from that, see how he became an influential judge, despite being a two-day judge in the Supreme Court, is an interesting story in itself. Because when he joined Supreme Court, when he was elevated to the Supreme Court from the Calcutta High Court, he was earlier the Chief Justice of the Calcutta High Court. He was elevated after the Modi government came to power in 2014, the first term. And when the then Chief Justice elevated him, he was part of the collegium. In the beginning, there was no indication about the likely influence which Justice Arun Mishra would play in the coming years. But the subsequent Chief Justices started reposing a lot of faith in him and started assigning politically sensitive cases as the master of the roster. Because the Chief Justice also plays a very important role as an administrative head of the Supreme Court. As an administrative head of the Supreme Court, the Chief Justice assigns the cases, determines the roster, and he also enjoys considerable amount of discretion in deciding which judge should hear a politically sensitive case. So therefore, when we see the pattern emerging subsequently, we find that the successive Chief Justices have been assigning politically sensitive cases to Justice Arun Mishra. Okay. And the outcome has always been in favor of the government. So we tend to, draw a sort of inference that this assignment has also, you know, been with a predetermined objective.
That's right. In fact, the title of your third article in the series is As Judge, Justice Arun Mishra was almost predictable when the state or the government was before him. But before we come to some of those more specific issues, since you mentioned the role of the Chief Justice of India as the master of the roster, after all, Justice Arun Mishra served under 7 Chief Justices of India, including the 3 in the collegium that recommended his elevation.
That's right.
If you will recall, the most controversial press conference that took place on the 12th of January, 2018, where after the Chief Justice, at that time it was Justice Deepak Mishra, 4 of the senior most judges, Justice Chelameshwar, Justice Madan Lokur, Kurian Joseph, and of course, Justice Ranjan Gogoi, who went on to become the Chief Justice, they flagged the discretionary manner in which the then Chief Justice of India, Justice Deepak Mishra, had been allocating cases, particularly to Justice Arun Mishra. And one of the more controversial cases pertained to the unusual death of Justice Lawyer, B.H. Lawyer. And you recall that our present Home Minister, Mr. Amit Shah, was discharged from the Sohrabuddin Sheikh fake encounter case because the Supreme Court relied heavily on statements made by Justice B.R. Gavai, who was then a judge of the Bombay High Court, and he's now, of course, a Supreme Court judge. If you can kindly elaborate on these two issues, that unprecedented media conference by the 4 judges in January 2018 and the Judge Loya case with Justice Mishra subsequently to come.
If you recall the 2018 press conference by the 4 senior most justices, you would find that the issue of the controversy about Justice Arun Mishra being assigned the Loya case was not the principal issue which they talked about in the beginning. They were talking about their letter to the Chief Justice Deepak Mishra earlier, which went unaddressed for a long time. Though Loya was a trigger that day, they all went to meet Justice Deepak Mishra, Chief Justice Deepak Mishra, and he didn't you know, culminate in a satisfactory solution. That is why they went ahead with the press conference. But it Justice Gogoi mentioned about lawyer case in answer to a question. They themselves did not come out with that. But my subsequent interaction with some of the judges who held that press conference, they tend to show that lawyer issue was not the trigger. Because what was the trigger for press conference was that, you know, certain cases which were assigned to these judges, four judges, were taken away from their cause list all of a sudden without notice, without discussion, and assigned to others. So lawyer was not one of them, but they were aggrieved because, you know, they were about to hear certain politically sensitive cases. They were, some of them even part heard. So they were removed all of a sudden, deleted from their cause list and assigned to others without any reason. So they were aggrieved because of that. That was a predominant reason. Lawyer was also a factor which Justice Gogoi had mentioned at that press conference. And subsequently, you know, what happened is history. The lawyer case was removed from Justice Arun Mishra's the three-judge bench.
But it was of course dismissed.
Yeah, but after a lengthy hearing.
Okay.
Or now, some can say, the ends were, natural justice was not given a due importance, all that. But it was after a lengthy hearing.
Okay. Okay, Venkateswaran, let's talk a little bit about the Sanjeev Bhatt case. Here we had an officer of the Indian Police Service who had alleged that the then Chief Minister of Gujarat, Narendra Modi, and Mr. Amit Shah were present at a meeting on the 27th of February 2002.
Right.
And he had leaked email messages of Tushar Mehta, who was then the additional Advocate General of Gujarat, and who is now the Solicitor General of India. And Mr. Sanjeev Bhatt is languishing behind bars. Now, could you elaborate on this particular case?
The present Solicitor General Tushar Mehta and Sanjeev Bhatt were close family friends. They used to vacation together. So there was a lot of interaction. So in one of those going out for a vacation, Sanjeev Bhatt had chanced upon certain emails of Tushar Mehta, and he had took copies of that for later use. And then he brought to the knowledge that he has been in touch with the accused, and so this amounts to collusion and also the contempt of court, because the administration of justice also suffered. So all this was brought to the notice of the court in this case. And then, you know, the kind of victimization which Sanjeev Bhatt had to undergo subsequently. So all this was brought to the knowledge. And again, there was a lengthy hearing. But the result was, the judgment was authored by Justice Arun Mishra. And so that was the end of it.
Okay. Mr. Venkateswaran, can we talk a little bit about the Sahara Birla Papers? I have co-authored a book which deals with...
I know, I have read that book also.
Okay. You know, this started with a petition by Common Cause, and I'm a member of the Governing Council of Common Cause.
Correct.
It started with the appointment of the K.V. Chaudhary, who had headed the Income Tax Department, then went on to
become the
Central Vigilance Commissioner, and who is currently a director on the board of Reliance Industries Limited. The dismissal of the case on the ground that these were loose pages, and the connection that people sought to draw, including by Dushyant Dave, the senior advocate, that, you know, the papers allege that money may have gone to Mr. Narendra Modi when he was Chief Minister of Gujarat, roughly 25 crore. That money may have gone to Mr. Shivraj Singh Chauhan, who was the then Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh. And Mr. Dave pointed out that at the wedding reception or the wedding celebrations of Justice Arun Mishra's nephew in Bhopal and in Delhi, Shivraj Singh Chauhan was present. So what are your views on this whole episode?
Well, see, Sahara Diaries, what the petitioner wanted was just a probe. So, on the basis of the material which appeared to be prima facie. But, you know, after a lengthy hearing, the conclusion was that they were all just loose papers, they don't merit a probe. So, one can disagree with that, but there was no other alternative. And, you know, how the case was assigned to Justice Arun Mishra's bench, that itself tells a story. Because it was first listed before Justice Kehar, who later on became the Chief Justice of India. So at that time, when he was about to hear it, Prashant Bhushan seriously objected because there was a conflict of interest. The Prime Minister was sitting on the proposal to elevate him as the Chief Justice of India. Therefore, he should recuse himself. And Justice Kehar got very angry that day during the hearing. And then finally, he agreed to the merits of what Prashant Bhushan had argued and assigned it to the another bench. But, you know, a bench of his own choosing. Ideally, he should, you know, he subsequently became the Chief Justice, but he should have refrained himself from assigning that case to Arun Mishra because there was a conflict of interest in the, even in the very assignment,
okay,
which he did not agree and he went ahead. So that is how it happens. You know, ultimately, the role of the Chief Justice of India and the role of the Master of the Roster, the dividing line is very often blurred. And any attempt to reform is always resisted by the court.
Okay. It's interesting. I'm going to come back to Prashant Bhushan. I'm going to come back to another instance where Justice Arun Mishra refused to recuse himself from hearing a particular case. But before that, can we talk a little bit about the Haren Pandya murder case? Because Prem Shankar Jha, writing in The Wire, has suggested that Haren Pandya's murder case may have something to do with the manner in which Justice Arun Mishra became very important and influential. And we know that just a bench comprising Justice Arun Mishra and Justice Vineet Saran, they reversed the acquittal of the accused who in the Haren Pandya murder case. Now, this again is a politically very, very sensitive case.
Correct. The Haren Pandya murder case, as Prem Shankar Jha had pointed out, there were a lot of discrepancies which were never sorted out during the investigation. Now, another aspect of the whole thing is that whenever the lower court accused, the appellate court does not normally interfere and, you know, set aside the acquittal. Because lower courts are in a better position to appreciate evidence. So the appellate courts generally do not interfere. In a ton of cases, the Supreme Court has said, no, we don't want to, you know, interfere with acquittals because they belong to a separate category in themselves. So here is a case where the High Court had acquitted and the case comes up to the Supreme Court on priority. Because, you know, there must be hundreds of cases which are pending for years, which have to be listed before the court. The appeals by CBI, appeals by state. But this case was picked up and listed before Justice Arun Mishra as if, you know, a matter of design or something. And then the outcome, we all know.
Okay.
So,
can we talk a little bit about the medical college bribery case in which it was alleged that the then Chief Justice of India, Justice Deepak Mishra, his name came up in that case. Once again, we had Justice Arun Mishra saying, no, this is not a case worth considering. Would you like to elaborate a little bit about that? And after that, could you talk a little bit about the sexual harassment case against the former Chief Justice of India, Ranjan Gogoi?
So if you happen to be in the courtroom when this medical college bribery scam was being heard by Justice Arun Mishra, Prashant Bhushan as the counsel, he was telling the court that, look, this is the case which requires probe. I'm not saying, I'm not making any allegations. I'm only saying let it be probed. so that, you know, any element of suspicion which is there can be removed. So, but the court assumed that, you know, the very mention of the word corruption itself is itself can amount to contempt. So they said they dismissed the whole thing, and then they imposed heavy cost on the petitioner. So the question is whether even in that case, Justice Convilker's presence on the bench was questioned because of conflict of interest, because he was part of the original bench. He sat with Justice Deepak Mishra, and the objection was that he should not hear this case, but he refused to recuse because of that, on that issue. So therefore, there was a high court judge who was arrested, Justice Kudusi, and there was a complaint, there was a request for permission, which was pending before the Chief Justice Deepak Mishra. So all this was brushed aside, and then the petitioners were made to appear as if you know they made something. They filed two cases, one by Kamini Jaiswal, another by Center for Public Interest Litigation. So, as if it was a professional impropriety, the action was taken against them. So, all this ended up, you know, took the case into an entirely different direction. So, I feel, you know, what this shows is that the lineup of these politically sensitive cases and the assignment to a particular bench, you know, it didn't, you know, support the inference that the Chief Justice's master of the roster can always be impartial.
Now, I mean, I think this also became even more evident in the sexual harassment case against Justice Ranjan Gogoi.
Absolutely.
That was unprecedented. Would you like to comment on this case?
So one would have expected that even if Chief Justice, at that time Chief Justice Gogoi, if he had been innocent, he should not have sat on the same bench which he heard the case on a Saturday. He could have led the other bench to hear the matter, and he recused himself at the time of the dictation of the order. But the fact that he, you know, gave a lengthy prelude and about he wanted to exonerate himself, and then he asked the colleagues to, you know, hear it and dictate the order. So it doesn't really carry conviction at all. So he was, at that point of time, Justice Gogoi was a butt of ridicule by the entire media. They wrote editorials saying that the judge should not sit in his own cause. But all this went completely unanswered. And, you know, the subsequent events, we all know that former employee of the Supreme Court was exonerated and taken back.
And reinstated.
So reinstated. And there was no word from the court itself. Nobody asked the present Chief Justice of India, Justice Bobde, who was also the member of the three-member committee. Why did this happen? How did this happen? What does it suggest? Nobody, no journalist asked him.
And we still haven't got the report that had been...
Correct. That not only that report, the one which Justice Arun Mishra's bench commissioned, Justice A.K. Patnaik, he inquired about the larger conspiracy behind this. And he had submitted a report a year back. And that report has not seen the light of the day. And, you know, Justice Arun Mishra, during the last hearing of that case, I specifically instructed the registrar, it's a written order, it is there on the website, list the case after the report is submitted. Why the case was not listed? Was the registrar not bound by Justice Arun Mishra's order? It is intriguing.
Okay, let's move on. If you can give very, very brief comments on four cases that you mentioned, four of them. One is the appointment of Nageshwar Rao as the interim director of the Central Bureau of Investigation. Secondly, Wire versus Jai Amit Shah, that case. Three, the abrogation of Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir and the detention of important political leaders. And fourth, the Rajasthan case where it was Sachin Pilot had revolted against Chief Minister Ashok Gehlot. So let's quickly first talk about the appointment of Mr. Nageshwar Rao as an interim director of the CBI. A brief, few brief comments from you on it.
Yeah, when this was challenged again, Justice Arun Mishra bench concluded that there was nothing wrong in that because, you know, there was a tweet by Prashant Bhushan which suggested that, you know, the minutes of the meeting were not disclosed. There was a difference of opinion. The selection committee, the high-powered selection committee, did not approve of this. And then the Attorney General for India, K.K. Venugopal, he had told the court, no, Prashant Bhushan was wrong. Then Prashant Bhushan realized the mistake and admitted the mistake, and the contempt action against proposed contempt action against Prashant Bhushan was withdrawn by Attorney General himself. And what it shows is that, you know that case, how it ended up. So Justice Arun Mishra said, so we should inquire about the larger issue. Can counsel tweet about the pending cases? We should continue to hear this case, but nothing happened after that. And he because, you know, the at that time Solicitor General said, do not withdraw the case even if Attorney General is forgiving. Let us continue to hear the case and lay down certain principles for counsel to talk about pending cases in public. So it was sought to be enlarged. And during the hearing, Prashant Bhushan wanted the recusal of Justice Arun Mishra from hearing this case. Justice Arun Mishra practically refused to recuse himself, and he promised that he will come out with the detailed reasons for the same, which he did not come out. So okay. These are, cases which went out of the radar subsequently.
What about the case of The Wire versus Jay Amit Shah and the article written by Rohini Singh about...
Initially, when these cases were listed before another bench in which Justice Chandrachud was a member, Justice Chandrachud bench wanted some resolution. So they wanted the parties to sit across the table and find some solution. So when that did not lead to a solution, and the case lingered on, and subsequently the Chief Justice, in the meantime, the Chief Justice changed, and the case got assigned to Justice Arun Mishra. And the very first hearing of the case by Justice Arun Mishra put very uncomfortable questions about, how could media write such stuff and things like that without any provocation. So wisely, the petitioners wanted to withdraw the case so that they can fight it out in the trial court and not, get unfavorable orders from Justice Arun Mishra's bench. So this is how, cases of seminal importance, the petitioners began to get entertained doubts about the outcome, and then they withdraw.
Okay.
That's what happened. Yeah.
Okay. So in the case of the abrogation of Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir, they said, we had people like Saifuddin Soar saying, look, it has been claimed by the Jammu and Kashmir administration that I'm a free person, but no, I'm not free. See, my house has been barricaded. Comments on that particular case in the Supreme Court.
So what happened in Saifuddin Soar's case was that, Saifuddin Soar had traveled a couple of times to Delhi out of Kashmir. And his wife, who filed the case, did not find it very relevant to mention it in the petition. So when the case came up, the Solicitor General mentioned the instances when Saifuddin Soar was allowed to leave Kashmir and visit his family and for his medical checkup, etc., etc. So the court was asking the petitioner why these cases were not mentioned in the petition. So they did not find it very relevant because overall he continues to be in detention. So there are a few exceptions here and there for medical reasons or for meeting the sister. That should not alter the scenario.
Okay.
So that is how at that point of time. So had the petitioners persisted with it, then this omissions, the these were not deliberate omissions, but you know, the petitioner didn't think it serious enough to maybe mention. But the bench would have taken it seriously, and then it would have been outcome would have been against the petitioner. So the petition was dismissed.
And what about the Rajasthan case involving Sachin Pilot and others?
The Rajasthan case, you know, the High Court had stayed the Speaker's decision on the disqualification of the rebel MLAs. And these people had come to the Supreme Court for a stay on the High Court's stay order. Right. Now, the question is, there were genuine differences whether the High Court had the jurisdiction to do so. And whether the High and the, if the High Court does not have the jurisdiction, the Supreme Court was bound to stop it from going ahead. But that is why they went to the Supreme Court.
Okay.
But
okay.
The Supreme Court refused to interfere. So as a result, you know, in the meantime, the political crisis unraveled itself, and they patched up together. And then as a result, it was in a cold storage in the Supreme Court, the case as such.
Okay. The second part of your article in The Wire is titled Justice Arun Mishra's social conservatism was a key factor in his neglect of judicial precedents. And in that article, you cited a number of cases, including the one about whether the government has a duty to maintain the lingam at the Mahakaleshwar temple in Ujjain, whether there should be restrictions on worship at Deogarh due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Interestingly, at a time when Justice Mishra himself said, I don't want a celebration of his farewell, you know, after he retired from the Supreme Court, at an event where Dushyant Dave, the senior advocate, alleged that he was not even allowed to speak. And then we have another judgment about the Kerala case of Rehana Fatima, who allowed her children to draw on her body, and whether this is a case of child pornography or not. And of course, the judgment about the interpretation of the Hindu Succession Act, wherein commentators have felt that he has actually reinforced gender stereotypes. You cite these examples as instances of Justice Arun Mishra's social conservatism. Would you like to elaborate?
Well, this series of decisions, the examples which I have given, if you take that Ujjain temple case, right? There, close to his retirement, he posted an interim order, which is very interesting. The entire media missed it. This is the first time the Supreme Court has begun to monitor closely the daily rituals of a temple, Hindu temple, saying that you should hold the rituals in this particular manner, you should get directions from us. So all this, you know, micromanagement of rituals of a temple, unheard of, completely unheard of in the interim order. So how does this happen? Then he, about allowing the pilgrims in a Jharkhand temple, he says that, you know, despite this coronavirus and social distancing and all that, the rituals should still be allowed. He himself doesn't participate in the farewell function because of the threat of coronavirus. But he says that the pilgrims should be allowed to visit the temple with all the social the distancing precautions in place. So how do we interpret this, except that, you know, he has a very deep-rooted social conservatism? So if you take this Jharkhand temple issue, as well as this Ujjain temple thing, that is a precedent set up by Justice Deepak Mishra in the Gujarat case, where, you know, the during the riots, the many mosques were vandalized. The petitioners wanted to, you know, they wanted the state to spend on the rebuilding of this demolished structures. So the case, they lost the case in the High Court. They came to the Supreme Court, right? And the Supreme Court said, no, the state is not bound to spend money on this because it's against secularism. So that precedent doesn't hold water. in this case. That is really surprising. And he doesn't even refer to that case as if it doesn't exist.
So he ignores judicial precedence. And would you like to briefly comment on Rehana Fatima alleged child pornography case and the judgment about the Hindu Succession Act and the stereotyping of men and women?
See, in the Fatima case, there can be two views, right? So Justice Arun Mishra is attached to his view, personal view. But here the issue is not that, because it does not even reach the merit stage. She is before him for anticipatory bail, as the High Court had rejected that. High Court had rejected that because it started considering merits. And then it found it abhorrent that how could a anticipatory bail be given to this. But Justice Arun Mishra himself had authored a very detailed judgment on anticipatory bail early this year, in which he had laid down clear guidelines. So you cannot deny anticipatory bail just because the accused may commit crime in the future, right? So, but this is what he said during the arguments to the counsel. When the counsel said, no, she has not violated any law. And he said, no, we don't want her to commit more crimes. So what is not in the order, it's mentioned in the arguments. And then the doors for anticipatory bail is closed. His own precedent is being ignored. So the question is whether you are having a particular view, ethical view, moral view on a particular issue. But as a judge, is not a judge expected to overcome his prejudices, biases on a particular matter and apply the law strictly as the law stands? That's the issue.
Okay. We'll talk a little bit about the third article that you wrote, where he said that he was always predictable, almost predictable when the government was before him or the state was before him. And we know that the government is the biggest litigant. And we all know that Justice Arun Mishra praised Prime Minister Narendra Modi at a conference where he described him as an internationally acclaimed visionary who thinks globally, acts locally. Now, you cite a number of cases. One is the transfer of Gautam Navlakha from Delhi to Mumbai by the National Investigating Agency, where he overruled the Delhi High Court judgment, Justice.
Right.
Okay. And in the same case, or a related case, I should say, the Bhima Koregaon case, he rejected the bail application of Anand Teltumbe. Now, yes. He's always stood with the central government's view in this. And you cite more examples. The Mulchand Khairati Trust, Khairati Ram Trust, which runs the hospital, versus the Union of India about allocation of beds. Yes. Then the case of Jaikishan Singh, whether or not he was a freedom fighter at the age of 7 or 8. Reservation of posts of teachers belonging to the scheduled tribes. And of course, the refusals to postpone examinations, the NEET, the National Eligibility and Entrance Test, and also the Joint Entrance Examination Test. Almost always, it seems, Justice Mishra's position was that of the government of India. If you can briefly comment on some of these cases that you highlighted in your article.
So some of these cases may be very minor, but what I found was that a pattern was emerging. When you study these cases, when the state was an appellant, he always ended up favoring the state, whatever the issue. So it was easy for the litigants to predict the outcome of the case when the state was the appellant. But having said that, and when the state was the respondent, again, there were certain exceptions. That's what I was trying to say. And some of these exceptions were also controversial. So, but you know, having found all that, the last order which he had passed, which I had not dealt with it in this 5-part series, the AGR issue, where the center said 20 years, he said no, 10 years. So that was really an inexplicable part of the whole thing. Why did he do so? Because the center, if you go by his pattern, he should have agreed with 20 years. He did not do so. And he did not give reasons also.
It's interesting to mention this because Abhijit Dasgupta and I, we've written about this. And we've also written about the seven judgments that have come in favor of companies in the Adani
Group.
The most important one pertaining to the Rajasthan distribution, electricity distribution companies and compensation and compensatory tariffs where Adani Group company could gain almost like 8,000 crores around it. A brief comment, because it seems both in the AGR judgment, the adjusted gross revenues, as well as the Adani judgments, in which Dushyant Dave had written an open letter and circulated it among all the judges of the Supreme Court, and it was public. What are your views on these particular judgments pertaining to the Adani Group and also the telecom judgment?
Yeah, the Adani case, as you yourself had pointed out, there was a judgment by the two-judge bench by Justice Nariman, wherein you know it is clearly said that the Adani Group could not have you know shirked its responsibilities. So that was ignored completely in the final judgment. He refers to that and then says he doesn't think that the principles lie down in that judgment apply to this case. So basically, you know, the conclusion is inescapable that, you know, he has been always, you know, differential to the views of the state. So as far as even these cases are concerned. So, the AGR case, which I have not clearly applied my mind to that because it still seems to be inexplicable part. So maybe some experts could throw more light on that.
All right. One of the more controversial positions that the retired judge Arun Mishra took was in the interpretation of the laws relating to land acquisition, the 2013 Act. There were two judgments, one pertaining to the Indore Development Authority, the other relating to the Pune Municipal Corporation. This is essentially land which is acquired and then it lapses, and whether if the compensation is paid to the government treasury, whether it's adequate or not. Now, at one stage, Justice Madan Lokur and Justice Kurian Joseph, in a related case, Haryana Government versus GD Goenka Tourism Corporation, was on the verge of alleging judicial propriety. But the question, the bigger question, is how can one judge, how can one bench of the Supreme Court set aside the judgment of another bench in the Supreme Court? And then this key issue, which was a very, very important issue, was apparently not addressed. If you can sort of demystify and explain this judgment for the benefit of the viewers.
Yeah, see, basically what happened here is that, to give a little bit of background, the 1894 Land Acquisition Act and the 2013 Act, which replaced it, the 2013 Act gives far higher compensation for land acquisition, whereas the 1894 Act gives less. So there are certain norms which go with this, and the one bench ruled that, you know, if the amount is the compensation need not actually be given, but even if it is deposited in the treasury, then it should have been enough. But then another view of another bench is that it's not enough. Even if it is deposited in the treasury, it doesn't amount to grant of compensation, so therefore the acquisition would lapse. So there are two conflicting views which needed to be sorted out. Now the question is, should Justice Arun Mishra have sat in the bench or the constitution bench which heard the matter to sort this confusion? Now, he, according to him, when he gave the very lengthy judgment refusing recusal, when the petitioner said Justice Arun Mishra should not sit on the bench because he had earlier given a contradictory view, and when the constitution bench is set to hear the whole matter afresh, the same judge should not hear his own view and decide. So that was a very fair point. But Justice Arun Mishra relied on precedents. He says here that in the Keshavananda Bharati case, you know, Keshavananda Bharati recently passed away. So he's very much in the news. So what happened in that case was 13 judges were on the bench. And the majority was 7.
The biggest ever bench.
Because after that, 13 judges had never sat. So it was a 7-6 decision. Very narrow decision, right? So 7 judges were in the majority, 6 were in the minority. Of the 7 judges, 2 judges had sat on the Goloknath bench earlier. Goloknath bench, it was in 1967. So in that case, the court had held that the parliament had no power to amend fundamental rights. So there also, it was a narrow majority. It was 11 judge bench. It was a narrow majority. It was 6-5. So 2 judges who sat on the Goloknath case also sat on the Keshavananda Bharati case, because at that time, the doctrine of necessity kicked in. What is the doctrine of necessity? Supreme Court at that time consisted of 15 judges. 13 of them were on the bench. Only 2 judges were left out. These 2 judges were on the verge of their retirement. So there is a view that no, even then, the 2 judges who sat on the Goloknath bench should not have sat on the Keshavananda bench, and they should have let the 2 judges sit on the bench, extend their tenures. Technically, it's possible. Even if the judge is about to retire, he can still continue to, you know, serve if there is an extension given. The Constitution permits that, but it has not been so far exercised. So at that time, it could have been done. But nobody objected to Justice Sikri, who was the Chief Justice at that time, who was also sat on the Goloknath bench, sitting again in the Keshavananda bench. There was no objection as such, because the doctrine of necessity was there, and people thought that since then,
in the land acquisition matter, this whole issue about whether one bench can set aside a judgment of another bench on interpreting the law was never addressed.
Yeah, because you know, in the land acquisition Indore Development Authority case, the issue was, they both were co-equal bench, 3 judge benches. So Justice Arun Mishra bench overruling the decision of a previous bench, which was also a 3 judge bench, was a issue. Because in the Justice Arun Mishra bench, one judge dissented. Justice Mohan M. Shatanagowda, he dissented, and he put down his view that no, that previous decision could not be declared per incurium. Per incurium means not to be followed as a legal principle. So he disagreed with the majority judges. But even then, the majority judges did not agree with him on the need to refer it for consideration by a larger bench. But it's only after this whole issue became controversial during the hearing by Justice Lokur and Justice Kurian Joseph that the issue got finally referred to the Constitution by the then Chief Justice Deepak Mishra, who had this issue in mind that whether a same bench can, you know, overrule the decision of a similar bench, you know. But that issue was never addressed by Justice Arun Mishra finally.
Venkateshan, I have 2 more questions for you. We are all aware that a bench headed by Justice Arun Mishra had held Prashant Bhushan guilty of contempt of court. He was convicted and fined 1 rupee. What is also not so well known that in an earlier case pertaining to acquisition of land for the Hyderabad Outer Ring Road, Justice Arun Mishra had threatened contempt of court against senior advocate Gopal Shankara Narayanan. And subsequently, he profusely apologized to the advocate. Could you recount the circumstances under which this happened?
In the Hyderabad case, he did not apologize. He apologized only in the later case when the Indore municipal case was being argued. He was presiding the constitution bench. At that point of time, Gopal Shankar Narayan wanted to make submissions. He was stopped. So that became an issue with the several senior advocates protesting the following day that Justice Arun Mishra should not have done like that, because the younger advocates would be reluctant to, would be deterred from arguing before him if he behaves in that manner. So Justice Arun Mishra apologized when several senior advocates had made the protest. So the Hyderabad case was a little earlier when this happened. Gopal Shankar Narayan was threatened with contempt, and he persisted in making submissions because the CB had found several irregularities, and the bench itself had acknowledged the CBI's findings in the disorder. But subsequently, the relief was not forthcoming to the landowners. So Gopal Shankar Narayan was representing the landowners, and he wanted to make submissions regarding that, and the bench refused to hear him, threatening contempt action against him. And ultimately, he was not heard, and the order was delivered without hearing him.
Okay. My last question to you. The fifth and final part of your part of the series of articles you wrote for The Wire, of which you're a consulting editor, has a title, "In Deciding Constitutionality of Enactments, Justice Arun Mishra Has Always Deferred to the Centre." You cite a particular case, the PNDT Act of 1994. PNDT stands for Preconception and Prenatal Diagnostic Techniques Prohibition of Sex.
Right.
But you make a fairly strong statement. You said Justice Arun Mishra's record as a Supreme Court judge shows that he has never needed much convincing about questions of constitutionality, where the government of India, where the central government has taken a particular view. So I'd like you to comment on why you wrote what you did, and conclude this interview by recounting why you believe Justice Arun Mishra became such an influential and controversial judge of the Supreme Court of India.
See, one of the legal principles while determining the constitutionality of statutes, when someone challenges a constitutional provision, the judges generally assume that the impugned provision is constitutional. It's called presumption of constitutionality. So the burden is on the petitioner to prove prima facie that it affects the fundamental rights. Then the burden shifts to the state. Okay, so in that sense, that is why judges are generally reluctant to grant a stay in the beginning of a hearing of a case, because they presume that the statute is constitutional, the constitutional provision is constitutional, because the state, the legislature has enacted that. I have to deference to the legislature, the doctrine of separation of powers. So unless it is proved that they will be very reluctant to step in. So that sense, Justice Arun Mishra was entitled to that view as a judge. But the question here is whether when the petitioners pass the prima facie test and the burden shifts to the state. So even then, we find that in most cases, the constitutionality is decided in favor of the state. So that is the pattern which is emerging in this whole thing. So I gave two instances of PIL cases which were listed before Justice Arun Mishra, and subsequently the one of them withdrew and another was not heard. So I'm saying these are the lucky petitioners, in the sense one had questioned the mode of appointment of the election commissioners. The petitioner wanted Baranwal, the petitioner wanted a collegium instead of the executive deciding who the commissioner is, election commissioner is, because it's a very important issue, because it raises a larger question of holding free and fair elections, which is considered as a basic feature of constitution. Yeah. So very important case. So the case was first deleted from the cost list twice in February. In March, it was listed, it came up, but because of lack of time, Justice Arun Mishra could not hear it. So that was in a limbo. So we all know about the outcome of the petition filed by Prashant Bhushan, Arun Shouri, and N. Ram. So the petition was initially listed before Justice Chandrachud and Justice K.M. Joseph, and it was later deleted from that list and listed before Justice Arun Mishra. And Justice Arun Mishra was about to hear it when they said, we are withdrawing the petition and with the liberty to move the appropriate forum. So Justice Arun Mishra agreed to that. So basically, why did they do that? They did that because, if you look at the pattern, he was likely to have dismissed both the Election Commission petition as well as the petition filed by the trio challenging the constitutionality of contempt of court provision, which enables the state, which enables the court to criminalize the scandalization of court offense.
So your concluding remarks, what kind of legacy does Justice Arun Mishra leave behind him? I mean, we had a former judge, Justice Rekha Sharma, actually suggesting, quoting others, of course, that she was happy.
The point is, Justice Arun Mishra never decided any cases alone. He was always part of the benches. There were other judges. So therefore, the concern is about the whole character of the Supreme Court over the years. Has it undergone a change? So that is the concern. So the question is not about a single judge. The question is, even if you take the Prashant Bhushan contempt matter, so a lot of attention has been directed on Justice Arun Mishra. But what about other judges who sat on the bench? Indore municipality. What about other judges who sat on the bench? There was no dissent. Therefore, as the character of the court itself been changing, so this is a larger concern which we all be concerned about. Now the question is, how such judges get appointed to the court? So we have the NJSC judgment, which was delivered way back in 2015. There were two parts.
Judicial Appointments Commission.
Correct. That's right. So in 2015, they delivered two judgments. One was invalidating the NJSC. And in December 2015, the Constitution Bench of five judges delivered unanimously, without any dissent, about the need for reform of collegium. So that issue remains unaddressed. So what does it say? It says we need a secretariat. We need to lay down the eligibility criteria. We need transparency. So we need a revised memorandum of procedure. Revised memorandum of procedure has not seen the light of the day. So many petitioners have approached the court. So we need to revise this case. We need to issue a notice of contempt to the center for not revising the memorandum of procedure. So what did the Chief Justice, successive Chief Justices have been saying? They have been saying that, look, this is an administrative issue. We will tackle it administratively. Then what was the need for hearing the NJSC case? In the very beginning, they could have said, it's an administrative issue. They heard it, delivered a judgment, not one, but two. And the collegium issue remains unaddressed.
Okay. Thank you so much, Venkateshan, for holding forth, for speaking in such great detail, not only about Justice Arun Kumar Mishra, who retired on the 2nd of September, but a host of other issues, all of which pertain to bigger concerns that citizens have or should have about the working of the higher judiciary in India. Thank you once again, and thank you very much for being with us on NewsClick. Keep watching NewsClick. We'll be right back.